Hey folks! Kilt-Man here! Kilt-Man! The Kilt-Man of the opera is here, at your service. Let's turn it down a bit. The ambience, yes. Gothic? No? Look at this chap. Who is he? Ah, you know. The Phantom of the Opera is here. Now this, of course, is the original Lon Chaney Sr. Let's get that bit right. Lon Chaney Sr., the man of a thousand faces. From the 1925 classic horror movie, Phantom of the Opera, Carle Laemmle of Universal Studios, who was producer of a slew of the most, you know, prestigious and most cherished of Universal horror movies. And of course, this was a lavish production at its time. A silent movie, Lon Chaney Sr., the man of a thousand faces, had done Quasimodo. And of course, he was a master of his own makeup, an artiste of the macabre. He would change his face. He knew how to contort his face. And the clever thing about him was that he knew how to, you know, stretch his face, make expressions, wild stuff. And then he would apply spirit gum, collodion, wires to try and fix his face into nice rigid grimaces. And this is by far his most famous appearance, The Phantom of the Opera. It was filmed in black and white, obviously. It was a silent movie. The film has had several versions have been re-released over the many, many, many decades. And Technicolor scenes and hand-tinted scenes were in the movie. So the big masked ball ceremony where he wore a skull and a scarlet cloak was just resplendent. Three-strip Technicolor and hand-tinted imagery. Now, you're going, why is it green, no Kilt-Man? Why is it green? Well, I shall tell you now. This mask here, this one, right here before you now, is from Trick or Treat Studios, and they released two masks from The Phantom of the Opera, the 1925 Lon Chaney Sr. version. And one is the flesh-coloured one, which is what you would have seen in the movie, albeit black and white, and then with the hand tint and the one or two Technicolor scenes were thrown in there as well. You would have seen a flesh-coloured death mask, which is what this face truly is, because he is Erik. Erik, who lives in the labyrinthine catacombs beneath this Paris opera house, and his muse, Christina, he's tutoring her from behind the scenes. He wants her to take over for an epic production of Faust. He will kill to get her on stage. But of course, he's twisted. Not only is his flesh deformed, he's deformed from birth, by the way, before you can think of, oh my God, it's a revenge plot. It's not quite that story. Although that's been done in various remakes. He's been damaged and it's been influencing many, many movies since. Theatre of Blood with Vincent Price, The Abominable Dr. Fives with Vincent Price, very, very similar. An artiste or a genius in a particular field who then is driven to absolute madness, mayhem, mutilation and murder, you know, because of a past of grievance. But Erik is deformed from birth. In the story, Gaston Leroux's classic story, he travels the world and learns the skills that will enable him to become this master sort of stealthy spy beneath, you know, this lavish opera house. And he builds it. He actually builds the opera house. So he puts into it underwater, like, death traps and canals and escape rooms and, you know, all secret passageways, his own hidden lair. He has all this stuff working in there. And the film, Carle Laemmle's, I'm sorry, I just heard a candle begin to hiss and spit wax then. Considering I've got a lot of latex masks just out of shot over there, this could get very, very dangerous, you know. It could, couldn't it? Ooh. Yeah. But he has all these death traps. So the film is not only a horror movie, a lavish production with thousands and thousands of extras, big dance and opera numbers, but it's a big cliffhanger movie when the detectives try to save Christina, who are the really shit detectives, I'll be honest. One of them even passes out a couple of times. He's meant to be the hero, he passes out. shades of Johnny Depp's Ichabod Crane from Sleepy Hollow? Maybe. But he is a monster. He will kill. And yet you do feel massively sorry for him, because Lon Chaney was a master, not just of masks and makeup and transforming himself into macabre characters. He could, okay, it was a silent era, so everyone, you know, really gives it loads and pronounces things and really elaborates and makes it really, you know, signposted what they feel and what they mean. But he was quite subtle in it as well. And his eyes conveyed so much emotion and pathos. Gesticulations of the hand, he was very theatrical, but he knew how to kind of rein it in for the cinema screen as well. So you got to know his character, and you felt revulsion, fear, hatred, and also sympathy for him. Sympathy for the devil. And it's a very clever, astute piece of performing art that Chaney came up with there. And he'd do many, many more. But the thing is, Towering Glory is without doubt the Phantom of the Opera. Now, again, I was saying before about why is it green? Because Trick or Treat Studios have released two, one with the flesh colour, one with the green colour. The green colour is, there's a very, very immortal horror movie magazine, a tome, Famous Monsters of the Filmland. Forrest Ackerman, Forry, produced this magazine. And on one annual, it was the yearbook, I forget which year, but they had, he was the poster boy, woohoo, and they coloured him green. And it was a spectacular look, and I think you'll agree. Now, I could have bought either version, but I went for this, and my God, I absolutely, truly, truly adore this mask. By the way, that's not coming away from any glue there, that's just because I've been playing around with it. Because when you get this mask, or when I got this mask, the hair was all flicked back. If you watch the movie, his hair, because he's receding anyway, and he's got a skull cap on, the hair, and he's all, he's deformed anyway, but his hair is a sidewinder. There's a few spindly, bits going over the top of the head. And so I've actually tried to, do a bit of a comb over effect on it. But look at that face. Sculpted by Justin Mabry, who is the demigod of Trick or Treat Studios. They're all great guys, all the sculptors and the artists that, fashion these masks. But he is, without doubt, one of the most luminary of names there. And it captures every facet. Both masks, the flesh coloured and this one, are exact reproductions of what you see in the movie. And to get that upturned nose effect there, what Lon Chaney did, he had fish wire attached to his nose, which ran up into the skull cap that he was wearing, to turn his nose up like a snout. And he had a lot of nosebleeds because of it, but he put up with it, because he was a champion of his arts. The teeth, a lot of false teeth. He used fish skin to get this sort of, what would be a translucent and stretched effect across the skin, and also put all these horrible striations and contours in. Enormous amounts of eyeshadow to give a sunken look to his face, this cadaverous skull face. And of course, as I said before, the massive expression when Christina, played by Mary Philbin, finally, goes to unmask him. One of the most famous scenes in horror cinema. And it is very, it's pure silent here. It's also a bit of Tex Avery sort of cartoon, because he's sitting there playing the piano for his grand masterpiece, which he wants her to perform. And she leans in to go, because he wears a mask to cover his face, as you would. And she leans in to take the mask off. And he sort of moves up like that, and her hands come back, and she's like, and then she leans in again. And finally, she pulls the mask up, but what you see, I'm Mary Philbin. This is what you see on screen. You see the mask come off, and you see his face, and you see it. And that's the audience back in 1925, and pretty much every generation since, they've gone, in a real great combined gasp of horror. But she hasn't seen the face yet. And he goes, like that. And then he turns around to face her. And then you see her reaction. And She goes, what you've just done, and you do it again to mimic her. And it's brilliant cinema. It's brilliantly conceived, brilliantly constructed, brilliantly choreographed, and directed, you know, to within an inch of its cadaverous life. But look at this face. Look at this face. We have this upturned nose. We have these stretched, striated cheeks. We have those sunken eyes with an amazing amount of, well, what would be dark eyeshadow in his case. But it's just this cadaverish face. A full head mask, as you've seen. That is the emblem there, the logo. Imprinted on the back there. There is, for those of you that love this stuff, of which I know there are plenty of you, inside here we have it's slightly rubbed away, but there's the pumpkin logo in there. I can't see any, oh no, he says. There is something here. 973. It's very small letters, numbers there. 973. This has catapulted itself to the top ranks of my masks, of which I have hundreds now. And this is absolutely gorgeous. Mainly because I love that green paintwork on it. I love that. I'm glad I got this version. You know, whatever version you go for, you know, it's going to be gorgeous. But this just gives it a whole new shimmering, you know, gruesome afterlife. It is phantasmic, without a doubt. Look at it, look at it. It is an absolute beauty. I'm just sitting here actually admiring it right now on the lens there. And I am. And do you know what? I have the mask of Bub, the zombie, the intelligent zombie from George Romero's Day of the Dead. I've done a video on it. And I do see a lot of Bub in this. Not so much the upturned nose and the green colour, although he is kind of, Bub's a mouldy, sort of browny, grey, green, but you know. But there is a look of Bub, you're probably not going to get that right now, but in 3D, right in front of you. Yes, you, Bub. I'm getting that. So I do think maybe that George Romero and Tom Savini, who did, you know, George Romero directed Day of the Dead, Tom Savini, the godfather of gore from the 70s and 80s, was definitely inspired. Now, we know Tom Savini was inspired by Lon Chaney Sr. as well for his amazing inventiveness. So was Rick Baker, so was Rob Bottin, so was Dick Smith, the great Dick Smith, who worked on The Exorcist. All these makeup experts revered Lon Chaney Sr. Collodion, fish wire, spirit gum. Everything he did to his face was dangerous and painful, and yet he did it for the art of the movie and to create a character. You have to admire that in every way. And look at this. Look at this. This mask itself is a genuine work of absolutely gruesome and macabre art. It's beautiful. It's not glow in the dark, although having said that, I have put this since it arrived. I've put it over yonder, beyond the bed. Me and Mrs. Kilt-Man will be relaxing. She'll be, you know, doing one of her, you know, Candy Crush stupid games or Sudoku, and I'll be reading some kind of epic tome of horror movie mayhem and werewolfry, or watching my own videos back. I don't do that, honestly. I'm not that vain. Am I Erik? But, and this will be down at the far end of the bed on a chest of drawers. And in the half light, it does seem to glow. You're probably getting that now. He says, putting a latex mask very dangerously close to naked flame. Not a good idea, is it? Now, again, the green effect. I've heard people saying to me, that green one, it's because... And, you know, a lot of horror movie aficionados will know what I'm going to say next. Jack P. Pierce, who did all the makeup effects for the Universal movies, pretty much onwards, i.e. Boris Karloff's Frankenstein, Lon Chaney Jr., his son, as the Wolfman, the Mummy, Boris Karloff again, Tom Tyler and Lon Chaney Jr. played the mummy, and a lot of makeup effects. For Son of Frankenstein, and I think for Bride of Frankenstein, Boris Karloff's makeup was then painted a very strange green colour. And the reason for that was that on black and white film, that green sheen, when it was produced, when the film was actually produced, it gave Boris Karloff's monster a very grey, cadaverish look. It just gave it that slant. So people have said to me, oh, the green one is because of that. That they painted it. No, they didn't. It was a flesh-coloured mask. Everything he applied was flesh-coloured. He didn't transform the colour of the face at all, apart from the dark eyeshadow. This mask here actually just purely emulates that magazine cover, that yearbook for Famous Monsters of Filmland. That's all it is. But it does look incredible. And, you know, for my money, that's the one which I was more smitten by. And I genuinely adore it. I say, that looks like it's coming free. It's not. It's just got lifted in all this operatic chaos. If I could have had a chandelier crashing down. Ah! Was that Christina? Did she bring us our tea? Also, when Lon Chaney Sr. first applied this makeup, he did it behind closed doors. No one knew what that look was going to be. So he called in the cinematographer, whose name sadly eludes me at this present moment. And he said, you know, knock, you know, come in. And the photographer walked in, and Lon Chaney had his back to him. And he's like, what do you want, Mr. Chaney? And Chaney turned around, like that. And the cinematographer went, ah, for fuck's sake, what the fuck? You know, maybe he didn't say the F word, but he was like, what are you trying to do to me? Are you mad? And Lon Chaney Sr. famously said, like, thank you, it works. In other words, yeah, I've got it. And he knew exactly how to put that onto screen and to make that unmasking and unveiling so memorable and so impactful. And the clever thing about it as well is that in the movie, that's a midway point. Now, I know, you know, all the experts of Phantom of the Opera out there are going, well, Kilt-Man, there's many versions of Phantom of the Opera. There are. There's at least three, maybe four versions. Initially, they put in too much opera, too much weirdy stuff for a silent movie. Too much stuff that wasn't horrific. And then he went back in and then he put more of this, or they trimmed out some of the more boring bits and put more horror and action and chasing and adventure. And then another version came out where they kind of condensed even more of, you know, all these elements. So you can get now on Blu-ray, pretty much all the versions that were ever released of this movie are there in one package, and you can pick whichever one you like most of all. But, you know, it is a chase, thriller, action, detective movie, more than just a horror movie. The horror is great, but because of the unmasking halfway through, you then see him pretty much the rest of the movie. He's like this. In later versions, the unmasking would be saved until the end of the film. And in many ways, you think, oh, that's probably a good thing, build up suspense. But it didn't work in that way because we already knew the unmasking was a huge thing. Why build up to it? That shouldn't be the ultimate moment. That should be, you know, get on with it. Show us his face and then let's see him do his, you know, his nefarious plans, put him into action and all this kind of, you know, weirdness that he's got in store for Christina and the opera house itself and anyone who gets in his way. Get on with that side of things. Don't be building up and up and up with mystery and suspense to that moment, because we already know he's going to be disfigured and horrific. So we're prepped for it. Get that bit out the way. So folks, trick or treats, Phantom of the Opera, absolutely bloody gorgeous, as green can be. And for those of you that do like these things, it's also got one of the best tags that I've had for a mask at all. There is the original, or one of the many original poster artworks for Phantom of the Opera, because he swims underwater with like a snorkel, and he sneaks up on a victim to pull him down to the depths in the canals beneath and drown him. And that's the image of him there, the snorkel, and his big red cape. It's outstanding, isn't it? There's the rest, there's the official, the back of it there. And your rules and instructions on how to look after your gorgeous mask. Keep away from naked flames. Do not wear whilst under the influence of whiskey. Yeah, well, rules are rules. Rules are meant to be broken, for God's sake. Isn't that right? Erik didn't follow rules. Erik did his own fucking thing. But yeah, guys, I'm sure you'll agree, that is one fiendish work of art. Let's give you a tour of it again. Look at it. I'll put it on again because that unmasking where he goes, he literally goes, the mask comes off and he goes, like that. Because it's, you know, how dare you? I've loved you. I've trusted you. I gave you my heart. I'm preparing you for stardom. And this is how you pay me respect. This is how you thank me. And he goes for it as well. Like, he threatens her even more. But he does love it. And there is a kind of redemption through love thing. This sort of movie, when you go back to it now, you go, oh, you know where to go. You know what's going to happen. It's set all the tropes for many, many stories and movies from that day onwards. I'm going in again for my own aria. Aria! Obviously, in this day and age, you'd be like The Who. You'd be like smashing guitars and setting fire to drum kits and all that. Like, you'd be a fucking wild child, a rock god, wild child. But also a musical genius. What do you think of this? I like it. I'll report back tomorrow from the flaming wreckage of Kilt Mansion, sitting there. Like that, with dust and like bits of the ceiling collapsing around me, and Mrs. Kilt-Man in the background roaring at me, "You fucking idiot!" Dario Argento, the great Dario Argento, who did one of my favourite horror films of all time, Suspiria, and Deep Red, and a lot of giallos, and then fell disastrously off the high pedestal that he built for himself with a slew of catastrophically bad movies. He did a version of Phantom of the Opera, which was absolutely one of the worst pieces of dreg I've ever sat through. Robert Englund also portrayed Erik, you know, as the Phantom in a gore-laden version in the late 80s, and it was quite enjoyable, I'll be honest. I quite like that version, being as I have the uncut version. Aye. Lots and lots of excessive blood spouts. I mean, this guy was a devious, nasty bastard, he was, but he wasn't really a slasher, and like, because Robert Englund had been Freddy Krueger, and they brought him in to play another scarred, hideously deformed aggressor. Yeah, he sliced people up something chronic. It's a good version. I like it. Bit of time travel thrown in, which is a bit fucking iffy, but there you go. but this. And of course, you're hearing Tim Rice, Andrew Lloyd Webber, the immortal stage production of it, the musical version, which I've seen. Now, I am not a fan of musicals. I am not, genuinely not a fan of musicals. You know, it could be a great story, and all of a sudden, the cast erupt into song for the next 20 minutes, which has got fuck all to do with the actual story. So you're like, what about? But me and Mrs. Kilt-Man went to see the original stage production of Phantom of the Opera, oh God, way back in 1980, blah, 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 whatever. And we saw Michael Crawford and Sarah Brightman, which is the original version. And this now is Michael Crawford. And, Betty, some words do happen. Who knew he could do this? And it moved me to tears, I'll be honest. Absolutely moved me to tears. I haven't seen it since, because it's one of those things where you've seen a definitive version and you think any other version now will not top that. I know that a lot of people do think that way, and normally I'm like, no, help with yourself to see other interpretations. How many versions of, you know, classic horror movies have I seen readapted and redone over the years? But I think this is about to cut out. So if it's still running,